sure to hop on over to the Spiritual Broadcast Network. It's the go-to place for all things spiritual. You'll discover internet television shows that you won't find anywhere else. You can also choose from hundreds of hours of spiritual documentaries and movies. You'll enjoy on-demand and live internet television programming 24/7. Best of all, we add new dramas, comedies, talk, and reality shows, and more on a daily basis. So why spend countless hours searching the web when you can quickly find just what you want on the Spiritual Broadcast Network?
Wisdom Through Action is a contemporary sea-influenced school teaching the work of personal inner development in the system brought to the Western world by G.I. Gurdjieff and P.D. Ouspensky. Mr. Ouspensky said, "The most important ideas and principles of this system do not belong to me. This is chiefly what makes them valuable, because if they belonged to me, they would be like all other theories invented by ordinary minds." What he meant was that this system comes from higher mind, from conscious influence. It is an objective system to bring a man to awakening.
Welcome to Wisdom Through Action. Today's topic, your being attracts your life. I'm your host, Kay Smith, along with Cal Gorham. How many times have you read a book or attended a seminar, after which time you thought, okay, now I can change myself? Maybe an attitude, maybe taking on a different action. However, no matter what you did, no change took place. The reason for this is that knowledge must be combined with practical work on being in order to bring about understanding, resulting in a change. With today's show, you're going to know how these three areas of work interact with each other, as well as show you what you may be missing in your life. In about 5 minutes, we will be showing a video that represents work on knowledge, being, and understanding in a fourth way school. The fourth way teaches a man to change his being. This is the main difference between a contemporary fourth way school and all other teachings available to Western man.
So if you've ever asked the question, who am I? The answer would be, you are your being. Being is you, what you are. Not your body, it's not your personality. It is what is intrinsically you. And that includes your ability to do. So in his commentaries, Maurice Nicole said that it is necessary to understand the concept of being. And this is not an easy one to grasp. A study of your own being is essential to working on yourself. These timeless works of art, which we're showing on the screen now, represent a level of being. More than they represent a person or a personality, they depict a higher state of consciousness, a higher level of being that goes beyond where ordinary man spends most of his time.
The study of man's possible development begins with one quite important point. There are two sides of a man that must be developed, or we should say there are two lines of possible development that must proceed simultaneously. This is the line of knowledge and the line of being. The line of knowledge begins with self-knowledge because one of the most characteristic features of a man's present state is that he does not know himself. In order for this new knowledge to come, a person must be able to give up self-opinions and hear these ideas as new, without trying to categorize or attach them to preconceived or already existing ideas. Usually a person is given some knowledge and then they try to put it into being. A child learning to write is shown the letter and told this is a letter A. This is knowledge. Then the child learns to write the A, that is to put it into being. But it is not until the child can write words and sentences and begins to learn concepts of what the words and sentences mean that understanding takes place. Understanding means the work of three or more centers agree on the same knowledge in their own language at the same time. When the light bulb goes off, there is a moment of understanding. We love it when a child's face lights up because he or she can write the letter being, and even more when he or she understands what the word and sentences mean. That would be understanding. We are going to speak about knowledge, being, and understanding in this program so that eventually we can come to the idea that your being attracts your life. Now here is a 20-minute video that we have created to show what work on being means in a fourth way school.
School is an organization for the transmission of knowledge coming from higher mind to a certain number of prepared people. The most essential thing in school is the knowledge which comes from higher mind. This means that schools cannot be formed arbitrarily without participation of people who have obtained knowledge in schools. Another important factor? The selection of students. Only people with certain preparation and a certain level of understanding are admitted. A school cannot be open to all. It cannot even be open to many. A school is always a closed circle with the instructor in the center. Schools can be of very different levels depending on the preparation and the level of being of the students. The higher the level of the school, the greater the demands made upon the students.
This school uses a scientific approach suited for Western man. The first condition is to know what to do and why. If not, ask. The first principle of this school is to do nothing until you understand. And the result of every effort is measured by understanding. Understanding is the chief principle. The second principle of this school, you must not believe anything without verifying it for yourself. Accept it as a possibility or not accept it, but never act on blind faith. The second condition is that those conducting the school have the responsibility to keep people reasoning for themselves and not to allow or produce infatuation or imagination. There can and should be aims, no promises. If people want to study here, they must accept certain conditions. This means that they must be willing to make the work practical. This is done by working on both the line of knowledge and the line of being. Knowledge and being, developing together, gives right understanding.
For example, you may take a course in driver's education, read books, and observe others driving. This is obtaining the knowledge of driving. Then you get behind the wheel and try to apply the knowledge, and you practice driving. This is obtaining the being in relation to driving. You may jerk the car, make turns too fast or too slow. You're working on being. Then after some time, you have mastered driving, and you no longer have to think about driving. You just drive. Then you have being in driving. Together, the knowledge and the being give you understanding of driving. A person who only reads about driving or observes others driving does not have the being or the understanding. They only have the knowledge. For them, driving is only a theory. It is not practical.
Here in this school, we teach knowledge and being, leading to understanding in relation to sleep and awakening, the development of a conscious soul. This is not a devotional school with the teacher and the pupils grouped around the teacher, in which the pupils are required to accept what is said as truth, a kind of faith, without verifying it for themselves. Devotional schools have been common in the East in the past. They usually require a withdrawal from life and a giving up of all one's possessions to study with a teacher. This is a scientific school designed for Western man who needs to verify things for himself in order to understand. It also does not require a withdrawal from life in a giving up of one's possessions, career, family, etc. Again, there are no conditions here except one. Try to understand what you are doing. This is a scientific, esoteric, Christian approach, suited especially for Western man.
Schools are necessary to those people who already realize the inadequacy of knowledge collected by the ordinary mind and who feel that by themselves, with their own strength, they can neither resolve the problems which surround them nor find the right way. The object of school must be to help a few suitable men to create conscious souls. In order to understand why schools are necessary, it must be realized that the knowledge which comes from men of higher mind can be transmitted only to a very limited number of people simultaneously, and with the necessary observance of a whole series of definite conditions which must be well known to the instructor of the school, and without which knowledge cannot be transmitted correctly. The existence of these conditions and the impossibility of doing without them explains the necessity of an organization. The transmission of knowledge demands efforts both on the part of him who receives it and on the part of him who gives it. The organization facilitates these efforts or makes them possible. These conditions cannot come about by themselves. A school can only be organized according to a certain definite plan worked out and known long ago. The origins of our civilization lie in the schools of Egypt many thousands of years ago. For a time, the Hermetic mystery was the form of school teaching. Hermes, while wandering in a rocky and desolate place, gave himself over to meditation and prayer. Following the secret instruction of the school, he gradually freed his higher consciousness from the bondage of his bodily senses, and thus released his divine nature, which revealed to him the mysteries of the transcendental spheres. He beheld a figure, terrible and awe-inspiring. It was the great dragon, with wings stretching across the sky and light streaming in all directions from its body. The mysteries teach that the universal life was personified as a dragon. The great dragon called Hermes by name and asked him why he meditated upon the world mystery. Terrified by the spectacle, Hermes prostrated himself before the dragon, beseeching it to reveal its identity. The great creature answered that it was Poimandres, the mind of the universe, the creative intelligence, and the absolute emperor of all. Hermes besought Poimandres to disclose the nature of the universe and the constitution of God. The dragon acquiesced. The growth of knowledge means a transition from the particular to the general, from details to the whole, from the illusory to the real. Ordinary knowledge, or what is called knowledge, is always a knowledge of the details without a knowledge of the whole, a knowledge of the leaves, or the veins and serrations of the leaves, without a knowledge of the tree. Real knowledge not only shows a given detail, but the place, the function, and the meaning of this detail in the whole. In our ordinary knowledge, there are times which bring us near to real knowledge. For instance, in the ordinary system of notation, any number not only defines the power, but shows the place of this power in the series of powers from zero to infinity. All real knowledge is of this nature.
Real knowledge comes from higher mind, that is, from the minds of men who have attained the fullest development possible for men. It is called objective knowledge, as distinct from knowledge of ordinary men, which is called subjective knowledge. Objective knowledge is always school knowledge, that is, knowledge acquired in a school. A man cannot arrive at it with his own mind or get it from books.
Objective knowledge shows that a knowledge of the real world is possible. One is able to approach this knowledge only if he is able to make use of the principles of relativity and scale. One must also already have knowledge of the fundamental laws of the universe, that is, the law of three and the law of seven. The approach of the study of objective knowledge begins with the study of an objective language. The next step is the study of oneself, which begins with the understanding of man's place in the universe and the study of the human machine. The knowledge of oneself is both an aim and a means. A man who has not had school teaching, that is, a man of a subjective way of thinking, lives surrounded by illusions, first of all about himself. He thinks that he has will and the possibility of choice every moment of his life. He thinks that he can do. He thinks that he has individuality, that is, something permanent and unchangeable. He thinks he has an I or ego, also permanent and unchangeable. He considers himself a conscious being and supposes that he is able to arrange life on earth by following the indications of reason and logic or logical method. His usual state of consciousness in which he lives and acts, he calls clear consciousness, when in reality it is sleep. In this sleep he lives, writes books, invents theories, carries on wars, kills other sleeping people, and dies himself without even suspecting for a moment that he can awake. He does not realize the possibility of the development of higher consciousness. He ascribes to himself that which he does not possess, but he does not know how much it is that he could acquire. If he is a man of scientific views, he does not admit the possibility of any individual evolution of man beyond the limits of ordinary intellectual development during life. Instead, he acknowledges the possibility of the evolution of man as a species, and he considers such evolution to be entirely mechanical, that is, not dependent upon anybody's will. If he is a religious man, he believes in a future life and that he is guided for his own good by higher powers with whom he can communicate by means of prayer, and that there is no personal effort required on his part to acquire a conscious soul. Not so. It requires great effort.
The fourth way begins with the realization, I am asleep. This is not a poetical statement, although most will argue that they are, in fact, fully awake and alert, walking around and conducting business. This is an illusion. The fact that we are walking around and conducting business only shows that we have learned to do these things while asleep. Once in a great while, a person may wake up for a moment and notice the difference in their state. Often this occurs in a moment of great danger or stress, such as in an automobile accident, where time seems to slow down and we may see things in a different way. Occasionally, a person may experience déjà vu, and ordinary things and events may seem to be filled with great meaning. In any case, the moment quickly passes, and we are left with only the memory of a memory.
The state of being awake is man's birthright. However, it is not given to him, it is made available to him. In other words, he has all the necessary organs for it, but he must learn how to make a special effort in order to develop his birthright. In the event he makes enough of those special efforts, and does so for a long enough time, and does so deeply enough, then the state of being awake may come under his own will and control. First, he must find a man, a school, who already knows what these special efforts are and how and when to apply them. And then he must find other people who are already in the school who also are attempting to awaken so that they can help him and he can help them. The school, the instructor, the fellow students, all are necessary. Uspensky said, "I have been asked several times why nothing is said about sleep in the Gospels. It is spoken about in the Gospels on almost every page. This simply shows that people read the Gospels in sleep. So long as a man sleeps profoundly and is wholly immersed in dreams, he cannot even think about the fact that he is asleep. If he were to think that he was asleep, he would wake up. Each living thing has a soul. This is the life principle. This is what differentiates a man from a lump of flesh. The problem is that we are put here with an unconscious soul, and what we need is a conscious soul, one that is awake. This is the basis of all religions, how to develop a conscious soul. The Gospels are instructions in this, in a religious language. Throughout the Gospels it says, watch, do not sleep. The Gospels are general in telling man what to do. This school tells each man individually how to do each thing, step by step, over time. Each person is different, with different abilities and different problems, and has to be treated with individual instruction and at his own speed. If successful, this will allow the student to come into contact with his higher centers and allow him to fulfill his birthright, his true potential as a conscious being, to be a man in the full sense of the word.
A fourth-way school in the Gurdjieff-Ouspensky tradition, centered in self-study.
We hope you enjoyed the show. Go ahead and read.
We all understand the idea of different levels of knowledge and the idea of relativity of knowledge and the necessity of new knowledge. What people may not understand is the idea of being as quite separate from knowledge, and even further, the idea of relativity of being, that is, different levels of being and the necessity for the development of being. So I'm going to read from Simple Explanation of Work Ideas by Maurice Nicole. Unless we see what factor in ourselves stands in our way, we cannot grow, cannot undergo an inner development. If we wish to develop, we have to be able to observe ourselves. It is usual to see all our difficulties as being due to causes outside ourselves, because this is all we do see. But if we begin to realize that it is ourselves, our level of being, that attracts our life, and understand the necessity of working on ourselves because our problem lies in ourselves, we can begin to change. If we can come to the point of realizing that our problems lie in ourselves, we know that everything depends on our efforts to change ourselves. And unless we come to this point of consciousness, everything will remain, not merely the same, but will get worse. We must try to discover by self-observation what it is that keeps us in the same place in ourselves. To change life means to change ourselves, but mostly we have the illusion that change for the improvement of our life depends on outer circumstances, and that those ought to be different. This is what makes us unhappy. The first thing we have to do to change ourselves is to give up our suffering. But people will not. They struggle to keep it. The work says that the world is governed not by sex or power, but by negative emotions. That is, by certain states of the emotional center called negative emotions. This refers to suffering. Unless we give up suffering, we cannot change. The first sign of a wrong attitude to life, the first illusion, is useless suffering. This happens because we approach life through our own ideas of what it ought to be and imagine that what happens to us is exceptional. All this produces suffering because we have not understood the nature of life and don't wish to know. We struggle with difficulties, yes, but think of our lives as spoiled. We therefore come to a new standpoint, that of realizing our lives are spoiled by suffering and wishing to be rid of all useless self-pity and the sense of grievance and despondency. We have to feel that life owes us nothing, that other people owe us nothing. On the contrary, we have to feel that we owe to others and owe to life more than we can repay. In the words of the Lord's Prayer, properly translated, we should ask for our debts to be canceled, as we cancel the debts owed to us, not forgive. As we eliminate from ourselves the idea that we are owed something by others, so do we become free. The feeling of being owed is useless suffering. When we struggle with this, we are suffering usefully. This effort needs work ideas. Life ideas encourage useless suffering, and in the end, deprive us of pleasure, happiness, and new interests. To change oneself, one must be free from petty attachments and forms of imagination about oneself that hold us in the position we are in life. We are attached to everything in ourselves: vanity, stupidity, merit, beauty, elegance, accomplishments, self-evaluation, etc., and particularly to suffering. These must be weakened for a change to take place. Or it may be that we are attached to the other side of the same coin, to the idea of not being ambitious, of not bothering about life. Now, to talk about the centers. The intellectual center is born with a negative part and a positive part, as in order to think, there must be a comparison, an ability to say yes and no. The emotional center is not born with a negative part. It should not be there, but it is acquired by the influence of people who are negative. By contact with adults, a child learns to pity itself, to feel grievances, to speak crossly, to dwell on its misfortunes, to be melancholy, moody, irritable, suspicious, jealous, to hurt others, etc. This dreadful infection of a child is something against which nothing can be done because it is not clearly recognized. This infection forms the negative part in emotional center. And this infection is handed on from generation to generation. Negative emotions may take very subtle forms, but eventually they all lead down to violence. Once negative emotion passes a certain point, it rouses deep-seated factors in the instinctive center, and people then want to hurt and murder one another. There is a particular reason why negative emotions are even worse than this. We have two higher centers in us, higher intellectual and higher emotional, that are fully developed and working, but we are not in contact with them. When we feel a lack in ourselves, an emptiness, a sense of futility and of being lost in a world we do not understand, it is due to the fact that we cannot hear higher centers. But if we made contact with higher centers in our ordinary state, our lower centers would be rendered 1,000 times worse, more intense. We can live in a better world. In this world, if negative emotions are reduced to a minimum. If, after having observed our negative emotions, we struggle with our emotional life, we shall see that our whole attitude towards life needs changing. It is impossible to overcome negative emotions alone, because they are involved in our whole attitude to life. Every situation needs a new standpoint by which to think of it. Our whole idea of ourselves has to be changed, and this is work on oneself. The work is designed to put us in touch with higher centers, but while we are governed by negative emotions, the influences coming from higher centers cannot reach us.
The movie Groundhog Day is a great representation of the idea that we were speaking about today, that of knowledge, being, and understanding. So in this short clip we're going to show here in a minute, the main character, played by Bill Murray, is realizing the fact that he is now repeating a day over and over, Groundhog Day. His being is at a very low level. He is negative and takes each day in quite a negative state. So Bill Murray, or Phil, the weatherman, is stuck in recurrence on Groundhog Day. He is filled with negativity that comes out during his weatherman filming.
This is pitiful. 1,000 people freezing their butts off waiting to worship a rat. What a hype. Not like they used to mean something in this town. They used to pull the hog out and they used to eat it. You're hypocrites, all of you. You got a problem with what I'm saying, Larry? Untie your tongue and you come out here and talk, huh? Am I upsetting you, princess? You know, you want a prediction about the weather. You're asking the wrong Phil. I'll give you a winter prediction. It's going to be cold. It's going to be gray. And it's going to last you for the rest of your life.
As the story continues, Phil, our main character, discovers that he is indeed stuck in recurrence on February 2nd, repeating it over and over again. And so how does he spend his time? Well, it's up to his level of being. He's spending his time gaining useless knowledge, referring to himself as a god, still living a mechanical, negative life with no change in being or understanding.
I'm sorry, what was that again?
I'm a god.
You're a god.
I'm a god. I'm not the god, I don't think.
Because you survived a car wreck? You folks ready to order?
I didn't just survive a wreck. I wasn't just blown up yesterday. I have been stabbed, shot, poisoned, frozen, hung, electrocuted, and burned.
Oh, really?
And every morning I wake up without a scratch on me, not a dent in the fender. I am an immortal.
Special today is blueberry waffles.
Why are you telling me this?
Because I want you to believe in me.
You're not a god. You can take my word for it. This is 12 years of Catholic school talking.
I could come back if you're not ready.
How do you know I'm not a god?
Oh, please.
How do you know?
Because it's not possible.
Doris. This is Doris. Her brother-in-law, Carl, owns this diner. She's worked here since she was 17. More than anything else in her life, she wants to see Paris before she dies.
Oh, boy, what a...
What are you doing?
This is Debbie Kleiser and her fiancé, Fred.
Do I know you?
They're supposed to be getting married this afternoon, but Debbie is having second thoughts.
What?
Lovely ring.
This is Bill. He's been a waiter for 3 years since he left Penn State and had to get work. He likes the town, he paints toy soldiers, and he's gay.
I am.
This is Gus. He hates his life here. He wishes he stayed in the Navy.
Well, I could have retired on half pay after 20 years.
Excuse me? Is this some kind of trick?
Well, maybe the real God uses tricks. You know, maybe he's not omnipotent. He's just been around for long. He knows everything.
Oh, okay. Well, who's that?
This is Tom. He worked in the coal mine until they closed the town.
And her?
It's Alice. Came over here from Ireland when she was a baby. She lived in Erie most of her life.
He's right. And her?
Nancy. She works in the dress shop and makes noises like a chipmunk when she gets real excited.
Hey!
It's true.
How do you know these people?
I told you. I know everything. In about 5 seconds, a waiter's going to drop a tray of dishes. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay?
Okay, that's enough. What about me, Phil? Do you know me, too?
I know all about you. You like producing, but you open for more than Channel 9 Pittsburgh.
Well, everyone knows that.
You like boats, but not the ocean. You go to a lake in the summer with your family up in the mountains. There's a long wooden dock and a boathouse with boards missing from the roof. In a place you used to crawl underneath to be alone. You're a sucker for French poetry and rhinestones. You're very generous. You're kind to strangers and children. And when you stand in the snow, you look like an angel.
How are you doing this?
I told you, I wake up every day right here, right in Punxsutawney, and it's always February 2nd. And there's nothing I can do about it. If you still can't believe me, listen. In 10 seconds, Larry is going to come through that door and take you away from me. But you can't let him.
Larry.
Please believe me. You've got to believe me.
You guys ready? We better get going if we're going to stay ahead of the weather. What's that?
We're going to stay ahead of the weather.
Little by little, we can see Phil's being begin to change and his understanding grow. In this final clip, you see that he has raised his impression and he's spending his time more wisely, working to change his being.
Please?
Oh, okay. I'm with a student now, but if you want to come back tomorrow, I can probably...
Well, I kind of want to get started. I could give you $1,000.
Got it.
From the point of view of his possible evolution, man is divided into 7 categories. People are born only in one category, one of the first 3 categories. So a person in whom the instinctive or moving center predominates and in whom the intellectual and emotional functions are less developed is called man number 1. But if the emotional function predominates over the other functions, he's called man number 2. And if the intellectual function predominates, he is called man number 3. Beyond these 3 kinds of men, but not born as such, is man number 4. This means the beginning of change, chiefly in consciousness, but also in knowledge and capacity for self-observation. Next comes man number 5, who has already developed in himself the 3rd state of consciousness, that is self-consciousness, and in whom the higher emotional function already works. Next is man number 6, and finally man number 7, who have full objective consciousness and in whom the higher intellectual center works.
In addition, we know that there may be very different men number 1, very different men number 2, and very different men number 3 living entirely under influences A. They may be equally affected by influences A and B. They may be more under influence B than A. They may have a magnetic center. They may have come into contact with school influence or influence C. They may be on the way to becoming men number 4. All these categories indicate different levels of being. The idea of being entered into the very foundation of thinking and speaking about man and religious thought, and all other divisions of man were regarded as unimportant in comparison with this. Men were divided into pagans, unbelievers, or heretics on the one hand, and true believers, righteous men, saints, prophets, and so on the other hand. All these definitions referred not to differences in knowledge, but differences in being. Nowadays, we ignore the idea of being and levels of being. We even think the more discrepancies and contradictions there are in a man's being, the more interesting and brilliant he may be. A man may be given to lying, be selfish, unreliable, unreasonable, perverted, and yet be a great scientist or philosopher or artist. This is actually impossible. The incompatibility of different features of one's being, which is generally seen as originality, is actually weakness. A man cannot be a great thinker or artist and have a perverted or inconsistent mind.
If knowledge outgrows being, or being outgrows knowledge, there is a lopsided development. The more you know yourself, the more you know your being. If you have never learnt that you have being, the being of all people would be the same to you. Someone who has never heard of self-remembering, if you ask him, will say certainly that he can remember himself. This is one being. Another knows that he does not remember himself. This is a different being. A third is beginning to remember himself, and this is a third being, and this is how it must be taken. Sometimes a change comes about due to a serious event in one's life. You may be familiar with the documentary I Am. In this film, producer Tom Shadeck explains a change that came over him. He had a moment of self-consciousness, a higher state, and a strong realization of what he needed to do. He realized that there was a problem in the world, and he saw that the problem was within, and thus the title I Am. He saw that he was living a life that did not actually make him happy. With this, he saw that he was the cause of what was wrong with his life.
My name is Tom Shadyac. I'm a movie director.
Action!
Facing my own death brought an instant sense of clarity and purpose. I decided to grab a camera and a film crew of four and start a journey to spark a conversation around challenging and rarely asked questions.
Have you ever seen any of my movies? Did you ever see Ace Ventura?
Ace Ventura? Did you ever hear that movie? It's a Jim Carrey movie.
No. See, I need a dose of
reality. We are asking some of today's significant minds, what's wrong with our world and what can we do about it? Most importantly, what we could do about it.
When I met this system, it showed me that change of being was necessary because we are not what we think ourselves to be. If we were what we imagined ourselves to be, if we had consciousness, will, if we could do, then only knowledge would be necessary. But we each imagine ourselves differently from what we are in reality. And it is exactly this difference between what we are and what we think we are that shows what is lacking in our being. Often we think we are changing, but actually we are in one room, running from one corner to another, not changing. In one corner we think we are one thing, in another we think we are different. We cannot change just because we have gone from one corner of the room to another. What looks like change is often change through imitation, change of conditions, likes and dislikes. The state of consciousness in which we are now always moves up and down.
Down means that we are nearer to sleep, and up means that we are nearer to the possibility of awakening. We're never exactly in the same state, and these small changes mean only marking time on the same spot. Changing being means acquiring consciousness, and it cannot happen by itself. So special efforts are necessary. In addition, being is your state, it's your inner state. It may be more united or it may be more fragmented. In one state, you can acquire certain knowledge, but if another state develops, you can acquire more knowledge. The idea is to study the state of your being and then, with a certain effort, to raise your level of being. No amount of knowledge can make being grow. You must work on knowledge and being separately. Otherwise, you will cease to understand the knowledge that you acquire. Work on being is different, and it requires a different effort.
In the work, we say that there are different divisions of man: his body, physical; his essence, life principle; his soul, asleep, embryo of conscious soul. His being is the state of the embryo of a conscious soul. It's like a baby. The being is able to do a few things in his body, like a baby who can walk and begin to talk. But he can only understand on a primitive level, or the level of a kindergartner, as opposed to a college graduate. When a person starts to work on himself to learn what his being is and how he can improve his being, he, so to speak, starts to go to school and learn not only knowledge, but also how to do.
So now it's necessary to speak about understanding. So what is understanding? Understanding is essential. What a man knows well, that's his preparation. And in order to do, a man must first be. In other words, he must have being. In the event a man has being and making coffee, this is a start. And in that case, a person has something to begin from. He can be talked to. Man has many false conceptions, wrong ideas about himself. Understanding may begin with a growth of consciousness in which these false ideas and conceptions, chiefly about himself, are dispelled. A man's chief delusion is his conviction that he can do. But everything happens. All that befalls a man, all that is done by him, all that comes from him, all this happens. Man cannot discover anything, invent anything. It all happens because man is a machine. All his deeds, his actions, words, thoughts, feelings, convictions, opinions, and habits, these are all the result of external influences, external impressions. A man thinks that others do things wrongly, but he does not understand that things have been done in the only way that they could have been done, because they happen mechanically. Most people think that having information is understanding, whereas that is simply knowledge. To know something and to understand it are two quite different things. In order to understand a thing, you must see its connection with some bigger subject, a bigger whole. And understanding means understanding the part in relation to this whole.
You know, there's a story you may be familiar with, The Blind Man and the Elephant. It's a good illustration of our misunderstanding of each other. So listen to the story. One day, three blind men happened to meet each other and gossiped a long time about many things. Suddenly, one of them recalled, "I heard that an elephant is a queer animal. Too bad we're blind and can't see it." "Ah, yes, truly too bad we don't have the good fortune to see the strange animal," another one sighed. The third one, quite annoyed, joined in and said, "See? Forget it. Just to feel it would be great." "Well, that's true. If only there were some way of touching the elephant, we'd be able to know," they all agreed. It so happened that a merchant with a herd of elephants was passing and overheard their conversation. "You fellows, do you really want to feel an elephant? Then follow me, I will show you," he said. The three men were surprised and happy. Taking one another's hand, they quickly formed a line and followed while the merchant led the way. Each one began to contemplate how he would feel the animal and tried to figure out how he would form an image. After reaching their destination, the merchant asked them to sit on the ground to wait. In a few minutes, he led the first blind man to feel the elephant. With outstretched hand, he touched first the left foreleg and then the right. After that, he felt the two legs from the top to the bottom, and with a beaming face, turned to say, "So, the queer animal is just like that." Then he slowly returned to the group. Thereupon, the second blind man was led to the rear of the elephant. He touched the tail, which wagged a few times, and he exclaimed with satisfaction, "Ha! Truly a queer animal, truly odd. I know now, I know." And he hurriedly stepped aside. The third blind man's turn came, and he touched the elephant's trunk, which moved back and forth, turning and twisting, and he thought, "That's it, I've learned." The three blind men thanked the merchant and went their way. Each one was secretly excited over the experience and had a lot to say, yet all walked rapidly without saying a word. "Let's sit down and have a discussion about this queer animal," the second blind man said, breaking the silence. "A very good idea, very good," the other two agreed, for they also had this in mind. Without waiting for anyone to be properly seated, the second one blurted out, "This queer animal is like our straw fan swinging back and forth to give us a breeze. However, it's not so big or well made. The main portion is rather wispy." "No, no," the first blind man shouted in disagreement. "This queer animal resembles two big trees without any branches." "Oh, you're both wrong," the third man replied. "This queer animal is similar to a snake. It's long and round and very strong." How they argued. Each one insisted that he alone was correct. Of course, there was no conclusion, for not one had thoroughly examined the whole elephant. So think about it. How can anyone describe the whole until he has learned the total of the parts?
Understanding in the work is understanding of the part in relation to the whole. So in this work, you are the whole that we are learning about in the work. The parts to be studied are many. They include your type, your features, center of gravity, strengths, limitations, personalities, acts, as well as understanding your place in the universe, the laws and influences you live under, what is possible, and how to reach your potential. As you gain knowledge about yourself, apply the ideas, and experience a change of being, your understanding begins to grow. Understanding may be seen as the arithmetical mean between knowledge and being.
Now, we read earlier from this book, A Simple Explanation of Work Ideas by Maurice Nicole, and I'm going to read a little bit more out of here. From the standpoint of this teaching, man is not one. He is not a unity. From the point of view of centers, he is three: an intellectual man, an emotional man, and an instinctive moving man. The work also speaks of man in terms of knowledge and being. These two sides form him. He is both, not merely his knowledge, not merely his being. First, consider being. Different kinds of animals have different being. The being of a snake is different from that of a grasshopper, and the being of a grasshopper from that of a pig. And a pig has different being from the being of a tiger. A carpenter selects his wood according to its suitability for a job. If some stock of wood has not matured rightly, he will say something to the effect that its nature has gone out of it. He is talking about being. It is not difficult to realize that people have different kinds of knowledge, but it is not easy to realize that they have different kinds of being. The conception of being is emphasized in the work, and we must try to realize what being is and why the concept is so stressed. So here's an example. A man of superior knowledge in his field, but who does all kinds of mean and petty acts, is full of envy, cheats, steals information without acknowledging it. Although this is obvious to us, he does not realize it and is astonished that people do not like him. Without understanding that this man has two sides, knowledge and being, we shall be baffled by him. We dislike his being, and we could describe his level of being as such and such. Here's another example. A man has no particular knowledge, but is not malicious, is not mean and petty, does not cheat, keeps his word. Although his knowledge is undeveloped, his level of being is higher than the first man's. If we value only knowledge, we shall admire the first man, whatever he does, because of his knowledge, and despise the second because he is ignorant. This judgment will define us, because we shall then have poor being. This is the tendency today, to make heroes of criminals, but a criminal cannot be taught, because his level of being will always use his knowledge in a criminal way. We make use of our knowledge according to our level of being. For instance, two people with harmful knowledge of a third person, it is their level of being which determines their behavior. From this we can see that knowledge and being are different, and that our relation to our knowledge is governed by our being. To give knowledge to a person of being lower than his knowledge results in its misuse. The work teaches that our knowledge and being should have equal development. If the two are approximately equal, the result is that we understand our knowledge. Understanding is defined as the resultant of knowledge and being. Knowledge by itself, being by itself, neither alone give understanding. We can know a lot and understand nothing. We can develop on the side of being to a point and yet be stupid or ignorant. In order to change, we must develop on the side of knowledge and on the side of being. If we only study the system intellectually, nothing will change. If we try to work on being without studying the knowledge, we will come to a stop. There will be no increase of understanding. When we begin to understand what we did not understand before, there is a chance of change precisely through the understanding. A man is his understanding, and he cannot develop save through his understanding. So we said this at the beginning. It is said that our level of being attracts our life, and that if we wish our life to be different, a change in our level of being is necessary. That means that as long as our being stays the same kind of things will happen to us, no matter the place or the circumstances. So that ends our show today. Be sure to visit us on Facebook, and we'll see you next time here on Wisdom Through Action.
Be sure to hop on over to the Spiritual Broadcast Network. It's the go-to place for all things spiritual. You'll discover internet television shows that you won't find anywhere else. You can also choose from hundreds of hours of spiritual documentaries and movies. You'll enjoy on-demand and live internet television programming 24/7. Best of all, we add new dramas, comedies, talk, and reality shows, and more on a daily basis. So why spend countless hours searching the web when you can quickly find just what you want on the Spiritual Broadcast Network?